Hey folks, how's it going? I've been above air 45 for a while now and trying to fix the gear on a couple of characters, but with very poor results. Maybe I'm being too stingy, maybe I'm just getting unlucky, I don't know. With this video, I kinda want to sit down and figure out what goes on who, which characters I want to pair together, and what options I have for their gear. For now, I'm still having a lot of fun with the free-to-play team, and I want to continue on that road until I max them all out before moving on to secondary projects. As far as artifact quality goes, being in the early stages of the endgame, I can't really afford to only invest into perfect artifacts with 4 desirable substats. These pretty much don't exist, nor to only look at 5-star artifacts for that matter. 4-star ones might be 20% weaker on average, but with alright substats will still be useful to complete these sets and will be replaced later on. The minimum requirement for an artifact to be worth investing into at this point would be to have at least 2 desirable substats. In order of importance, this would be crit rate, since pretty much anything except electro-based reactions can crit and inflict a minimum of 50% more damage, crit damage to boost said damage even more, elemental mastery to boost the reaction damage, and lastly, energy recharge and attack percent. With 5-star artifacts, attack percent loses a lot of importance since it begins to scale quite horribly as crit rate and damage become more prominent. Ideally, I'll want to reach at least 70% boost to attack, 50% boost to crit rate, and 100% boost to crit damage. A single sense artifact can take care of 46% of that attack requirement. An attack percent weapon can take care of the rest already. Otherwise, a few attack percent rolls in the substats, the pyroelemental resonance, the noblesse oblige attack buff, or a character's own passives will be enough to reach that threshold. Crit rate and damage should grow at a 1-2 rate past the 50-100 mark, and the circlet's main stat will depend on how much crit rate and damage the rest of the set rolls. If you want more detailed information about the damage scaling, I've linked the resource document I've taken this information from in the video description. So let's start with MC. Until now, I've been using her as a main physical carry with the prototype Rancor and attack physical damage attack artifacts. Hitting AR-45 though opens the road to a few more options, first one being the Viridescent Veneer set. This increases Animo damage by 15%, Swirl damage by a pretty nice 60%, and it also lowers the elemental resistance of the enemies caught in the reaction by 40% for 10 seconds. It sounds like a must-have for any Animo support character to pair with an elemental damage-based carry like Diluc, Kaching, Klee, Tartaglia, and so on. Since Swirl also gets a big boost in damage from Elemental Mastery, going Veneer support would mean having to craft the Iron Sting Sword and look for an Elemental Mastery main and substats for the artifacts. Priority-wise, Swirl as a reaction cannot crit, but the Animo damage from the E and Q still can, so no real changes there. This will also make it so MC only really comes out to use her E and Q, and I'll have to rely on other characters to deal most of the damage. Both Zhangling and Fischl deal mixed damage though, and they don't have that high of a hub time for their elemental damage output. The best free-to-play partner for this setup would be Lisa, but she's kind of locked on a reaction build too. Also, ever since release I've only ever gotten a single sword blueprint drop, which went into the refinement for the prototype Rancor. So while I'll be looking for and saving up for a proper support build, I think I might keep MC on a temporary physical-based build. The prototype Rancor is a given, I might still go for a Viridescent Veneer, but with attack, physical damage bonus and crit, prioritizing crit subs and some elemental mastery. Alternatively, a Thunder Suitor or Lava Walker set might work, since it boosts all damage by 35% as long as the enemy has an elemental status up, and Animo MC can spread them pretty easily with her E. The Gladiator still looks like an alright option, but the items I've gotten so far aren't anything to write home about. This set is actually harder to farm for since it's not a guaranteed drop from the 40 resin bosses, and the damage boost only applies to the normal attack damage. Now that I think about it, the Thunder Suitor, Lava Walker, and the upcoming Icebreaker set can all work well as generic sets. All you need is to be able to prime the enemies, which comes easily for anyone, and you've just got to watch out for the slimes in the environment. With these sets on, you can even ignore Elemental Mastery subs since you don't want to be causing too many reactions in the first place, and give priority to crit rate and damage, energy recharge and attack subs instead. The main issue would be that some reactions happen whether you want it or not. Lots of enemies in the wild carry pyro, all grass can be ignited, and then there's water and rain to take into account. But under normal circumstances, it would simply be a 35% boost in damage. All damage. For MC's Geo variant, the Archaic Petra set covers a similar role to the Viridescent Veneer. You need to prime a target, cause a Geo elemental reaction, and pick up the resulting shield shot to grant your team a 35% elemental damage bonus to that element for 10 seconds. Just like the Viridescent Veneer, this works best with characters who have a high elemental damage output. Still, it's yet another support-oriented set, and one I wouldn't put on MC due to her skill leaving obstacles around. On the other hand, the Retracing Bowlight comes with a 35% increase in shield effectiveness and a 40% increase in normal and charge attack damage while under the protection of a shield. If I wanted to keep a physical damage-based GOMC, I think this might be the best set to go with. Prototype Rancor, attack, physical damage, crit as usual, it loses the 18% boost to attack from the Gladiator, but that's not a big deal, and it brings a 5% increase in normal and charge attack damage. With a bit of energy recharge, it would allow GMC to have a better uptime on her Q as well, for yet another 10% crit rate buff. This set actually sounds great for most characters who like to click a lot, all you need is a Geo support or someone who can create shields in your team. Next in the list is Ember. Poor Ember. People believe that it is only the high tier characters that can make you have fun, but that is not what I have found. I think it is these small things, a bright smile, a cute animation, that can truly make the game more enjoyable. So, why Ember? Because she's the cutest thing in Teyvat, and the reason why I keep logging in every day. So far I've kept her on an Exile set with as much energy recharge as I could find. She still works well to knock down archers and shamans from their towers, stun ruin guards and hunters, and Baron Bunny has a couple of fun uses against seasoned mages and rock shield enemies. Still, I think I want to try and build her for headshot damage, see if it helps in a couple of abyss floors when I've had trouble dealing with the ruin guards. The set to do this are quite a few, starting with the Wanderer's Troop coming in with a flat 35% boost in damage for charged shots. The Elemental Mastery is also nice to help with Melt and Vaporize since those two reactions can actually crit. For her weapon, I've crafted the Prototype Crescent since the other one only boosts physical damage, and for the artifacts I'm thinking attack, pyro damage bonus and crit damage. Substats wise, all I care about is more crit damage. Some Elemental Mastery and Energy Recharge is not going to hurt, but mainly crit damage. Sadly, farming this set is in the same venue as the Gladiator one, 40 resin for no guaranteed drop, and despite the artifacts I've gotten so far being okay, they all have crit rate, attack and energy recharge, so I might just save them and try them on Mona should I ever get her C2. A second option would be the Retracing Bowlight, but it requires a Geo support. Then there's the Lava Walker, but this would suffer in stages that have the Elemental Altar or Slimes of any kind. And lastly, there's the Crimson Witch of Flames. This brings a 15% pyro damage bonus, going up by 7.5% after a Baron Bunny cast. It would bring the lowest 22.5% increase in damage, but it has no strings attached to it. The boosting reaction damage is almost the same as the Wanderer's Troop though, with plus 80 elemental mastery bringing a 15% boost in melt and vaporize, and about a 35% to overload and the rest. It would result in a bit more damage with her skills, but overall less damage with her ranged shots, so I'm afraid I'll just have to hope for better Wanderer's Troop artifacts. Another option for Ember would be a simple support setup with a Noblesse Obliged set, Ifa bonus Warbow, and a bit of a focus on energy recharge to use her Q more often and buff everyone's attack in the process. For Lissa, it's pretty straightforward. The only offensive craftable catalyst is the Mappa Mare, which comes with elemental mastery and some extra elemental damage bonus. For her, it's gonna be a Thundering Fury set. For main stats, either Elemental Mastery, Electro Damage Bonus and Attack, or Attack, Electro Damage Bonus and Crit. The first set would be more focused on reaction damage since the Electro ones can't crit, but I'm still curious to try the second one because her normal attacks still can, and she's gonna get a nice boost to Electro Damage Bonus from multiple sources. The substats don't change, it's going to be Crit, Elemental Mastery, Crit Damage and Energy Recharge. Next one is Kaya, who I only really bring up to deal with Electro Fatui. I'm not really concerned about him being able to do any damage, but I would prefer if the Q was available as often as possible. Like Ember, he's been on an Exile set for forever for that reason alone, and I've been thinking of upgrading to a Noblesse Oblige set for a nice 20% teamwide attack buff. Stats-wise, I don't think they matter that much, as long as there's an Energy Recharge Sands. Noelle has a few more choices available for her. For support, she could use the Maiden Beloved to boost her healing or the Archaic Petra to boost an ally's elemental damage. Or she could go the fun route and get a Retracing Bowlight. An extra 35% shield strength sounds great, and she's going to get an extra 40% boost in damage while constantly generating more and more shields. Despite being a defensive character, her main damage output still scales off of attack, with defense coming in to provide a bonus to it. She gets a defense percent stat increase as she levels up, and a few more defense substats in her artifacts should be more than enough to round out her kit. I've gotten the prototype Aminus as a pre-registration reward, and I'm not really planning to craft a white blind. Stats-wise, it's still all about crits, so attack stance, geodamage bonus goblet, and crit circlet should do the trick. Next up is Barbara, yet another character I've kept on an Exile set for a while. Despite still having 4-star artifacts that haven't been upgraded past plus 8, I don't feel like her heals are too small, so a Maiden's Beloved set doesn't really look all that appealing. I think I'd rather look in the direction of a Noblesse Oblige set for her as well. The 2-set bonus might not work, but a 2nd and O set in the team can bring a higher uptime for the 20% attack buff, and while this doesn't stack with itself, it should still stack with the Thrilling Tales of Dragon Slayers. I still want as much energy recharge as I can get on her though. Other than that, all she needs is HP. And now comes the hot part, Zhang Ling and Fischl. Both characters dealing mixed damage, both characters able to go either physical carry or elemental support. Right now, Zhang Ling is on a Gladiator set and she's doing quite alright with it despite only having her normal attack damage boosted. As a main carry, her role is to stay on the field and auto-attack when everyone else's skills are on cooldown, so she'll be carrying a Crescent Pike and attack, physical damage bonus and crit artifacts. For the sets, the Lava Walker sounds like a good option since Guoba and her Q can light everything on fire with a fairly large GOE. The Pyro Slimes wouldn't become any harder since they are already immune to pyro damage, but a 40% elemental resist would probably make some domains a bit easier. My main concern would be about farming the Electro domain since it's filled with slimes constantly reapplying Electro to themselves. A Lava Walker would be kind of useless there. Same goes for the slimes in the Abyss floors. The Crimson Witch of Flames is better suited for an elemental carry or a support that only has to cast skills and proc reactions though, so either she stays on her Gladiator or she's going to have to swap between the Lava Walker and the Thunder Suitor based on which content I've got to farm for. Another option for this sort of split damage characters would be a 2-piece Bloodstained Chivalry and a 2-piece Elemental Damage bonus. It would lower the physical damage bonus to 25% and the elemental 1 to 15%, but at level 80 with level 20 artifacts, the total physical damage would only go down from 124 to 114% while still bringing a 15% increase in elemental damage. It might not be much, but it does remove the headache of having to deal with self-priming enemies. Lastly, Fischl. She's kind of designed as a support DPS, with odds lasting quite a while and dealing some real nice electro damage. Too bad the attack bow has a passive for headshots and the other option is a physical damage one. Still, with her Constellation 1 she basically gets a 22% physical damage bonus which can be added to the compound's bow 63% at level 80 and 58% from a 5-star goblet, so a physical based build wouldn't be too unthinkable to go for. Bow users don't have the generic set for normal damage though, so it would be either a Thunder Suitor, Retracing Bowlight or Bloodstained Chivalry 2-piece for her. Stats-wise, it's always the same attack, physical damage bonus and crit. I would kinda need another bow blueprint drop before even considering this, and those seem pretty rare. I think I've only ever gotten 2 since release and never a bow. On the other hand, the Thundering Fury set is perfect for her and that's going to boost reaction damage as well as reduce the cooldown for odds. With her second passive talent dealing 80% of attack as electro damage on reaction, I think I would still go for the prototype Crescent and attack, electro damage bonus and crit main stats, but focusing on crit rate and elemental mastery as substats. This support-oriented setup would really benefit from a stringless though, which I currently don't have. I'm still kind of curious to try the 2 Bloodstained and 2 Elemental Damage setup, see just how much the damage of each type affects the overall DPS. They're in the same loot table as the Noblesse, so I'm likely going to save quite a few. So it looks like my main carries are going to stay MC and Zhang Ling, with Noelle hopefully being able to chime in from time to time. Fischl is still very much a work in progress, but I already love her, especially with the Battle Pass bow preventing enemies from flying everywhere on overloads. Domains-wise, I've got 1 Viridescent Veneerer, 2 Retracing Bowlight sets, 3 Noblesse Oblige sets, 2 Thundering Fury and 1 each of Thunder Suitor and Lava Walker to work on. I guess I'll farm for a few more Electro pieces and then try for a Lava Walker since I don't have enough DPS for the Bowlight domain. Once I fix Noelle up, I'm going to move on to the Noblesse ones. Alright then, that's going to be it from me for the moment. If you've got fixes and suggestions, I'd love to hear them. In any case, thanks a lot for watching and see you around soon. Ciao!